Is it possible that SpaceX has succeeded in making orbital launches boring? Increasingly, the answer to this question appears to be yes. The achievement is truly impressive, and many people are wondering how SpaceX founder Elon Musk reacted to this incredible achievement. The entire world is in awe of this incredible accomplishment, and today's episode of Science of Space will deliver into the specifics of this historic event. Eric Berger writes, SpaceX's three main competitors in Russia, Europe, and the United States have launched three rockets in 2023. SpaceX just launched three missions in 3 days. In response, Elon Musk said, provided there is no serious launch anomaly, SpaceX will deliver 80% of Earth's payload to orbit this year. Not counting Starship. On Friday, the California-based company launched two Falcon 9 rockets within the span of just a little more than 4 hours. At 12:26 p.m. local time, a Falcon 9 rocket carried 52 of SpaceX's Starlink satellites into low Earth orbit from a launch pad at Vandenberg Space Force Base in California. A mere 4 hours and 12 minutes later, another Falcon 9 rocket delivered two large communications satellites into geostationary transfer orbit for the Luxembourg-based satellite company SES from Cape Canaveral, Florida. This broke SpaceX's record for the shortest duration between two launches. However, the overall record for the lowest time between two launches of the same rocket still belongs to the Russian-built Soyuz vehicle. In June 2013, Roscosmos launched a Soyuz booster from Kazakhstan, and Arianespace launched a Soyuz from French Guiana within 2 hours. Those launches were conducted by two separate space agencies, on separate continents, however. Accelerating cadence. Friday's launch of the two SES satellites was, overall, SpaceX's 19th orbital mission for the calendar year. As of today, the company is launching a Falcon rocket every 4.1 days and remains on pace to launch approximately 90 rockets before the end of 2023. To put this into perspective, a decade ago, the United States launched an average of 15 to 20 orbital rockets a year. In 2022, the United States recorded its most launches in any calendar year ever, with 78 orbital flights. This year, barring a catastrophic accident with the Falcon 9 booster, that number will easily get into triple digits. The all-time record for orbital launches in a single year is held by the Soviet Union, with 101, in 1982. A decade ago, SpaceX was still an upstart in the global launch industry. In 2013, it launched the Falcon 9 rocket 3 times in a single year for the first time. This was actually a pretty monumental achievement for the company, as it introduced both its second launch pad at Vandenberg Air Force Base, and a substantially upgraded variant, 1.1, of the Falcon 9 rocket. It also flew commercial missions for the first time, and began experimenting with ocean-based landings. In that competitive environment a decade ago, SpaceX still lagged far behind its main competitors, including Roscosmos, Europe-based Arianespace, and US-based United Launch Alliance. This year those numbers have swung massively around. Through today, Russia has launched 3 rockets, 2 Soyuz and 1 Proton, in 2023. Arianespace has yet to launch a single mission, and neither has United Launch Alliance. No longer a competition. Put another way, SpaceX's main competitors over the last decade have launched 3 rockets this year. SpaceX, by comparison, just launched 3 rockets in 3 days, including the CRS-27 mission, flown for NASA on the evening of March 14. Increasingly, only the combined efforts of China's government and its nascent commercial launch sector can challenge SpaceX's launch dominance. That nation has a total of 11 orbital launches this year. SpaceX founder Elon Musk has said he would like the launch industry to achieve airline-like operation with rockets one day. His company is not there yet, as it takes a couple of weeks to land, refurbish, and relaunch a Falcon 9 first stage. Each mission still requires a brand new second stage. And the fastest turnaround time at its 3 launch pads, Cape Canaveral and Kennedy Space Center in Florida, and Vandenberg in California, is still about a week for each facility. But they sure have come a long way in a decade. It's clear that since SpaceX emerged in early 2010, they have been eating into ULA's market share, due to Falcon 9 rocket being sold at much lower cost than ULA's Atlas V and Delta IV rockets. As well as successfully suing US government for access to national security missions. This has had a severe impact on their profitability. Despite SpaceX's dominance, many companies could potentially be interested in buying ULA. Due to its significant assets including upcoming new heavy-lift rocket Vulcan, closing price gap with SpaceX. They have existing agreements with U.S. military to launch 60% of national security payloads from 2023 to 2027. ULA won commercial contract with Amazon for 38 Project Kuiper missions, have valuable facilities in Colorado, Alabama and Florida, and strong political capital in all states related. Potential suitors likely include parent companies, Lockheed Martin or Boeing, most likely Lockheed Martin. However, one of the parent companies, either Lockheed Martin or Boeing, could acquire the other. Lockheed Martin appears to be the more likely purchaser, given its recent strategic investments in the launch industry, like its stake in ABL Space Systems. This move would solidify Lockheed Martin's position as an aerospace leader. Amazon is also likely to be highly interested in acquiring ULA. Jeff Bezos' company already signed a Project Kuiper launch agreement, granting them knowledge of ULA's business, which would give Amazon priority access to Vulcan launches, and ensure the Kuiper constellation is launched on time, as well as strengthen their ties with the Department of Defense. Bezos' other company Blue Origin may also be interested in buying ULA, although there is a firewall between them and Amazon. Blue Origin has already won a share of Project Kuiper launches, with its new Glenn rocket, but there are questions about how quickly it can be used for commercial service. Purchasing ULA would help consolidate Blue Origin's share of Kuiper missions and secure guaranteed funding from the Department of Defense. Plus save money on Vulcan launches by providing BE-4 rocket engines at cost. Other potential bidders include Northrop Grumman, with vested interests in national security and reliable rocket motors for Vulcan. L3Harris, which recently acquired engine maker Aerojet Rocketdyne. A private equity firm, such as the one that A Industrial Partners invested in Firefly Aerospace, or even a tech giant such as Apple, looking to develop their own space constellation for communications purposes. Lastly, SpaceX may skip out on this purchase as there is nothing much they can gain from it. In conclusion, whoever purchases ULA will have several questions to address, namely how sustainably ULA can operate when faced with SpaceX's dominance. Other U.S. competitors like Blue Origin, Rocket Lab and Relativity Space are emerging, but do not yet pose an immediate threat. An investment into new technology will also be needed to remain competitive, in 5 to 10 years, when more companies could have fully reusable rockets, priced significantly lower than Vulcan. To remain competitive and innovative in this new era of commercial launch, ULA will require substantial liberation of resources. While price is a secondary consideration, Pentecost was clearly proud that the introduction of competition into national security launches has lowered prices. This can be traced to SpaceX's entry into the program in 2015, and particularly to the debut of the company's Falcon Heavy rocket in 2018. We've saved almost 50% over what the older prices were like for the Delta Heavy, Pentecost said. The Vulcan and the Falcon Heavy are about half the cost of what a Delta Heavy used to cost, in order to put the National Reconnaissance Office's biggest satellites into space. So we are saving a ton of money on the high end, while we're still managing to utilize the commercial prices on the low end. The military hopes that by opening Lane 1, it will be able to nurture still more competitors for high-value missions later in the 2030s. And it appears that the newer U.S. launch companies all have such aspirations. As we talk to the Rocket Labs, Relativities, the ABLs, they all talk about how they're expanding from their smaller launch focus into medium lift, Pentecost said. And everybody has plans to go even higher. Balancing range demand. One sign of the emergence of new competitors, as well as SpaceX and potentially United Launch Alliance ramping up their launch frequency, is the usage of the Eastern and Western ranges, operated by the U.S. Space Force. The Eastern Range encompasses Cape Canaveral and Kennedy Space Center, in Florida, as well as Wallops Flight Facility in Virginia. The Western Range includes Vandenberg Space Force Base, and other U.S. launch sites in the Pacific. Pentecost shared the following data about increasing launch cadence at both ranges, as well as a projection for this year. One of the reasons why they selected SpaceX is because they placed the Europa Clipper in Category 3 for launch services. This means that the Europa Clippers should be carried on a commercial vehicle that has performed at least 3 successful launches. This put the Falcon Heavy miles above competing commercial rockets. You see, SpaceX's Falcon Heavy was successfully flown 3 times, despite not being launched since 2019. Other competing vehicles such as United Launch Alliance's Vulcan Centaur and Blue Origin's New Glenn haven't even had their first launches. Yet the Falcon Heavy is also more efficient in terms of payload delivery. Compared to the other rockets, the Falcon Heavy is able to deliver 63,800 kilograms to Earth's lower orbit. While the Vulcan Centaur can deliver 27,200 kilograms and lastly, the New Glenn can deliver 14,000 kilograms and in terms of cost per launch. The New Glenn would reportedly cost NASA about $2 billion, to launch with them, and the Vulcan Centaur would cost them about $200 million. So it's a no-brainer why NASA went with SpaceX. It's cheaper, more proven, and far more efficient. The only issue with selecting the Falcon Heavy is that it's slightly slower than NASA's SLS. With the SLS, the Europa Clipper would have arrived at Jupiter's moon in less than 3 years, but with Falcon Heavy, it should arrive at Europa in about 5.5 years after it launches. Lately, the United States government has been putting a lot of faith in SpaceX. The Europa Clipper contract is one of several future Falcon Heavy missions with NASA, the Department of Defense, and private commercial clients in February. For example, NASA awarded SpaceX with contracts to launch the first 2 modules of the Lunar Gateway, and then in April, they awarded them with the contract to launch the Griffin Lunar Lander. That will be tasked with carrying a NASA lunar rover to the moon. If the launch of the Europa Clipper takes place in October of 2024 as planned, it is expected to reach Jupiter's orbit by April of 2030.